In this video, I'm going to present the main idea of the entire course. So listen up carefully. So, let's start with a problem. Let's suppose that you have a dollar and you invested in some stock that doubles every year, darn good investment, and you wonder how much money you'll have after n years. Now, we write this in terms of equations. We say, you know, x of n is how much money you have after n years, and our initial condition is you start off with $1. And our equation is that the amount that you have each year is twice what you had the previous year. And some people write it as the amount that you'll have next year is twice the amount that you have now. It's totally equivalent. This n is one less than this n. Okay, and now we just go ahead and figure out. The amount that you have after 1 year is twice what you had to start with, so that's $2. The amount you have after 2 years is twice that, so that's two times $2. The amount that you have after 3 years is twice that, so that's two times $2. And in general, the amount that you have after n years is going to be two times two times two times two. And how many factors of two do we have? Well, starting at zero, at what you started off with, you multiply by two n times. So of course, this just gives you 2 to the n. So the amount of money you have after n years is 2 to the n dollars. Great. And it's pretty easy to generalize this. If instead of starting with x of n is twice x of n minus 1, if we said x of n is some other constant times x of n minus 1, then at every year we would multiply by a, and we would pick up a factor of a to the n. Also, if we didn't start off with $1, if we start off with $7, we would have wound up with 2 to the n times 7. Or in general, you wind up with a to the n times whatever you started with. Every year you multiply by a, you do that for n years, you pick up a factor of a to the n. Great, easy problem. But now we're going to make it harder. Now we're going to look at coupled equations. Instead of having one quantity, x1, we have two quantities, x1 and x2. And I'll let you think of your own hokey word problem that they fit. But the rules are that x1 each year is twice the previous year plus whatever x2 was the previous year. And x2 each year is x1 of the previous year plus twice x2 of the previous year. And now you say, okay, how in blazes am I going to solve that? Because it seems that to solve the equations for x1, you need to know x2. To solve the equations for x2, you need to know x1. Everything is coupled. Coupled is hard. Now you can try writing things in terms of linear algebra. You can package x1 and x2 into a vector, and then you write down a matrix A, 2, 1, 1, 2. And let's suppose that we started off with x1 being 4 and x2 being 0. Sorry, x2 equal 2. And now our equations can be written in matrix form as the vector at time n is just 2, 1, 1, 2 times the vector at time n minus 1. Okay, and we can follow our previous reasoning. X at time 1 is a times x at time 0. X at time 2 is a times x at time 1, so that's a times x at time 0. And in general, x at time n is a to the n times x at time 0. There's only one trouble with that. How in blazes are you going to figure out the nth power of a matrix? It's not 2 to the n, 1 to the n, 1 to the n, 2 to the n. You don't just take the nth power of the entries. You have to somehow figure out the nth power of the matrix. And at this stage of the game, we don't know how to do that. So we got a solution that was correct, but absolutely useless. Later on, we'll get some insight on taking powers of matrices. But until we do that, this line of reasoning doesn't help us. We have to find another way to solve our coupled equations. And the answer is to switch to new coordinates. So instead of working with the x coordinates, I'm going to find some new coordinates, y1 and y2, such that x1 is the sum of the y's and x2 is the difference of the y's. Or equivalently, y1 is the average of the two x's and y2 is half the difference of the two x's. It's pretty easy to get these equations from these equations. And we're going to rewrite our equations in terms of the y's. So here are our equations. And if we take the sum of those two equations, We get that x1 plus x2 at time n is 3x1 times 3x1 plus 3x2 at time n minus 1. And if you divide by 2, this becomes y1 at time n. This becomes 3y1 at time n minus 1. So lo and behold, y satisfies a decoupled equation. You don't have to know anything about y2 to solve for y1. Likewise, if you take the difference of the equations and divide by 2, you get that y2 at time n is y2 at time n minus 1. So the evolution of y1 is easy. The evolution of y2 is easy. This is all summarized in a chart. This picture is the course in a nutshell. If you want to solve for x at time n in terms of x and time 0, that's a coupled problem. Coupled problems are hard. But if you switch to the y coordinates, you have to learn how to change coordinates. You have to learn how to go from one set of coordinates to another set of coordinates. And this is going to involve change of basis matrices. In the case of this particular problem, it was a simple sum and difference. In general, it's a little bit more complicated. But you convert to other coordinates, and then in the other coordinates, your problem is totally decoupled. You solve it one variable at a time, and that's easy. You figure out what y is at time n. And then you do another change of basis back to the original coordinates, and you figure out what x is at time n. So you don't go straight across the hard way. You ride the elevator, cross the bridge, and come back down. So let's do that for this particular problem. Riding the first elevator is easy. We said that y1 was x1 plus x2 over 2, so 4 plus 2 over 2 is 3. 4 minus 2 over 2 is 1. Check. This is 3, 1. Then we said that y1 of n was 3 times y1 of n minus 1, so y1 triples every time. So y1 of n is 3 to the n times y1 of 0. So 3 to the n times 3 is 3 to the n plus 1. y2 of n is 1 times y2 of 0. Y2 of n is 1 times y2 of n minus 1. You multiply by 1 each time. So you multiply by 1 to the n. And of course, that's 1. And so up here, this is 3 to the n plus 1, 1. And finally, we convert back. Y1 of n plus y2 of n is 3 to the n plus 1. Y1 of n minus y2 of n is 3 to the n plus 1 minus 1. And that's our answer. Okay. So what's the moral of the story? Well, the kind of coupled problem I gave you isn't the only kind of coupled system that you'll ever see. You sometimes see systems of first-order differential equations. Sometimes you see systems of second-order differential equations. And the point is, if the matrix was 2, 1, 1, 2, you would always use these particular changes of coordinates. The change of coordinates doesn't depend on whether you're talking about a difference equation or a first-order differential equation or a second-order differential equation, whatever. It's really a property of the matrix only. Now, once you've done the change of coordinates, you still have to solve the equations one variable at a time, but that's relatively easy. The right coordinates depend only on the matrix, and we're going to see how to figure out the right coordinates in terms of the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of a matrix. This matrix happens to have eigenvectors 1, 1, and 1, minus 1. And that tells you what the change of coordinates is. The eigenvalues are 3 and 1. And that tells you what are the numbers that appear in the equations after you do the change of coordinates. There's a machine for doing this no matter what matrix you started with, and that's what we're going to develop in the course of the course.